I'm going to be talking today about The Merry Adventures of Robin Hood by Howard Pyle. Now, this is a book that I picked up off the library shelves, not really knowing much about it. And unfortunately, in this edition, there's not really any publisher's introduction or anything like that. But I've been doing my research on Wikipedia, mostly, and searching around, and I believe I've come up with some background knowledge about this book. Actually, funny story, interestingly enough, it turns out that I did actually try and read this book as a kid. I didn't actually remember the name Howard Pyle, but I did try and read a classic Robin Hood book when I was in, I think, second grade. It was the Educator Classics version, those big, oversized classic books that maybe some of you will remember. And I for years, I didn't remember what the author of that book was. I just knew it was a retelling of the Robin Hood story. But there are so many retellings of the Robin Hood story that I wasn't quite sure which one it was. But searching around through Wikipedia and searching on the internet, I've come to realize that it was indeed this version. Actually, I just said there are so many retellings of the Robin Hood story, but it turns out that this is the classic edition. Yeah, let me qualify that statement a little bit. I've been talking about this book on my weekly reading vlogs, and I've been making some mistakes on there. Apologies for that. I believe I've been saying on the weekly reading vlogs that this was the first novel ever written about Robin Hood. That's not quite true. I mean, first of all, there's Ivanhoe. Now, Ivanhoe, I've not read that, but my understanding of Ivanhoe is that Robin Hood is a supporting character in the novel. The novel's not purely a retelling of the Robin Hood legend. So I'm not going to count Ivanhoe. We'll count that as a story that has Robin Hood in it, rather than a Robin Hood story. But, you know, if you go on Wikipedia and you look at their Robin Hood wiki, their Robin Hood template, they'll say the novels are Ivanhoe, and then there's something called Maid Marian, which is apparently a novella in the beginning of the 1800s, which I'm assuming focuses more on Maid Marian than Robin Hood, just based on the title. And then there's this book, Robin Hood by Howard Pyle, which was published in 1883. Now, if you dig around further on the internet, and you know, if you go on to the Robin Hood wiki, there's a whole wiki based on Robin Hood. It turns out there are many. There were several other Robin Hood novels published before this one, including, interestingly enough, two novels by Alexander Dumas, or Dumas, the writer of the Three Musketeers series. And I thought, oh, right. Well, I didn't know that, because I'm a huge fan. Well, I'm not a huge fan, but I'm a fan of Alexander Dumas. I was going to say I was a huge fan, but I can't call myself a huge fan because I've not read him exhaustively the way other people on BookTube have. But I've read the Three Musketeers series and loved it. I've read The Count of Monte Cristo and loved it. So I thought, okay, well, if there's a Robin Hood story that he did, let me search for that one next. And as far as I can tell, actually, I searched for the Robin Hood story by Alexander Dumas, which is actually titled in English Prince of Thieves, just like the Kevin Costner movie, although Dumas, I think, got the title first. That Prince of Thieves was the first one. He wrote two books. But anyways, takes you to the Amazon page, and the Amazon page says, okay, this has been out of print in English for years, but we're finally bringing it back into print, and it's available only on the Kindle. And I don't have a Kindle. I'm still old school, going for physical copies of books. So the point being, I guess, there were actually novels about Robin Hood before this one, but this is the oldest novel, or the first novel of Robin Hood, that's still in print nowadays. So, you know, that Alexandre Dumas book, it's no longer in print except in the Kindle-only edition. The various other Robin Hood stories that were published in the 1800s, no longer still in print. But this one has still been in print. This edition here is 2004, but I think it's been in print continuously since 1883. So it's not the first Robin Hood novel ever, but it's the first Robin Hood novel that's still in print. It's the earliest Robin Hood novel that people are still reading. So you could make the case for that meaning that this is the definitive classic Robin Hood. Or in other words, if you wanted to read a Robin Hood story and you wanted to go to the classics, you didn't want like a modern retelling, you wanted to go back to the originals, this is perhaps as close to the originals as you are likely to get. Unless you go and you search for something that's been long out of print, or if you go back and you read the original old ballads on which the Robin Hood legend first comes down to us. This book is largely based on those old ballads. But if you're looking for a novel and not the original ballads, this is the classic Robin Hood retelling. So I had been familiar with many elements of the Robin Hood story through cultural osmosis, movies, and, comic books and classics, simplified versions that I read as a kid. In fact, the one that had the biggest influence on me as a kid was a Fisher-Price classic comic book series where they came with a cassette tape and a comic book, and you listened to the cassette tape and followed along in the comic book. I don't know if anyone else remembers those, anyone else who was growing up in the 80s, but that's where I got most of my Robin Hood education from. And it's interesting to compare this with what we normally think of Robin Hood. Some of the classic elements are there, but some things are a little bit turned around or different. The biggest thing in this book, well, yeah, couple things, but the biggest thing is Maid Marian is absent from this book. Kind of. She actually pops up very briefly at the beginning. When Robin Hood is walking around, it says, Robin whistled as he trudged along, thinking of Maid Marian and her bright eyes. For at such times, a youth's thoughts are wont to turn pleasantly upon the lass that he loves the best. But then we never hear about her again. I think one other time in the book somewhere she's mentioned, and again, mentioned as a girl that Robin Hood is fond of. But other than that, no Maid Marian. And again, searching around on Wikipedia and doing some internet detective work, it looks like Maid Marian was not part of the original ballads that are the origins of the Robin Hood story. She apparently pops up in one of the later ballads, but only in one of the later ballads. And I believe Howard Pyle is basing this book mostly on the old ballads, which, again, were the original Robin Hood stories. Which is not to say that she didn't exist by Howard Pyle's time. She had popped up in other novels. I think she was in Ivanhoe. She popped up in stage plays. I think she was in the Alexandre Dumas version. I don't know. I'll have to double check the internet on that. So she was definitely a well-established part of the Robin Hood legend by the time this book was being written, but she wasn't in the old ballads much, which I think is why she's absent from this book. Excuse me. So Maid Marian. The other thing that really surprised me is Guy of Gisborne. Now, Guy of Gisborne pops up in different incarnations. Sometimes he's the Sheriff of Nottingham's cousin, or he's like the Sheriff of Nottingham's lackey. Sometimes Guy of Gisborne actually is the nobility, like in the famous 1938 Errol Flynn movie, Guy of Gisborne plays like the nobleman who is oppressing the poor people and who Robin Hood fights, and who also is Robin Hood's romantic rival for Maid Marian. But in this book, Guy of Gisborne is just a common criminal. He's not nobility, he's a low-born common criminal. And he's got a reputation for being a particularly ruthless common criminal, somebody who murders a lot of men. So the Sheriff of Nottingham pays him to go and kill Robin Hood. And then Robin Hood fights him and kills him. And I thought, all right, that's different than the Guy of Gisborne I knew. So again, doing some internet detective work on this. And it turns out that the original ballad in which Guy of Gisborne appears in is very similar to how he's portrayed in this book, as a criminal who's just hired to kill Robin Hood. The old, set a thief to catch a thief, I think is the expression. I could talk forever about all the things that are the same and all the things that are different between this version and the Hollywood version. And, you know, it's interesting if you want to go down those rabbit holes, and I did a bit while I was reading this book, Googling various names, checking up on Wikipedia, trying to see how the characters have changed through time, or, you know, were the characters in this book the same as they were portrayed in the original ballads, etc. I don't want to talk exhaustively about everything that's the same and everything that's different, though, because I've got other things I want to talk about. As I've indicated, this book is largely based on the old ballads, which were updated for an 1883 audience, although, curiously enough, not completely updated. The author, Howard Pyle, is using his own type of old English, or I guess maybe it would be called more Shakespearean English, if you want to get technical. I think technically old English refers to like what they were, you know, what Beowulf was. But what we would often colloquially call old English, let me see if I can find a good example of this. Here's a good example. Maybe just flipping open the book. Focus this here. "Now, art thou the man for my farthing?" cried the messenger. "And back thou goest with me to Nottingham town." "Nay," quoth the tinker, shaking his head slowly from side to side, "go I with no man, gin it be not with mine own free will." "Nay, nay," said the messenger, "no man is there in Nottinghamshire could make thee go against thy will, thou brave fellow." "Aye, that I be, brave." "Aye, marry," said the messenger, etc. You get the idea. Now, this book was written in 1883, so this language was long out of date by the time Howard Pyle wrote it. And Howard Pyle, by the way, was an American. So it didn't have to be written like that. He could have written it in a more modern tone, and probably if this book had been published nowadays, it definitely would have been, I suspect. But he's made this choice to imitate the style of the old ballads, at least in terms of the dialogue. The narration is mostly in a more modern prose, although sometimes the older English does sneak in even to the narration, especially during the dialogue attributions. So here's another example here. "Nay," quoth old Adam, "or the dell presently." So that quoth turns up a lot instead of said. But aside from the dialogue attribution and the dialogue, well, no, actually, sorry. Just looking at this page, this is the narration. Not spake the stranger, but took his place. Well, all was hushed. So, you know, that not spake. So it does creep into the main narration a little bit. It's mainly just in the dialogue. It's a little bit jarring when you first start to read it, and there were some words that completely confused me. The word what, W-O-T, kept popping up like I what, however it's pronounced. Eventually, I Googled it, and what, W-O-T, is an archaic form of no. So I what is I know. There were these words that are, you know, unless you're familiar with archaic English, are a little bit hard to decipher, but it never interferes with your understanding of the story as a whole. The story is written in a simple enough way that you can follow along quite easily, even if there's the occasional archaic word that I can't decipher. Just from the general context, I easily know what's going on. And it's the kind of thing where when you first start reading the book, it's a little bit jarring. But once you're a few chapters in, you don't even notice it anymore. I mean, by the time I got to the end of this book, I just completely stopped bothering me. I'd almost completely stopped noticing it. It does give this book a certain flavor. Maybe helps you to imagine the old times which Robin Hood and his men lived. But like I said, it's based on the old ballads. And because of that, it has quite an episodic flavor. So Robin Hood will go on one adventure, and then that will finish, and then he'll go on another adventure, and then that will finish. And also, I guess, because they're based on these old ballads, it's got a lot more of a folklore tone than I was expecting. You know, I was thinking of Robin Hood like Errol Flynn. He has all these sword fights and dashing adventures and swashbuckling, I guess is the adjective we would use. But a lot of the stories in this book are more like Robin Hood is playing the archetypal role of the trickster. So he'll think of some clever trick to get out of danger, or he'll think of some clever trick to annoy the Sheriff of Nottingham. So the tone of the stories is a lot more, it's a lot more like folk tales. And Robin Hood is the one going around tricking. That being said, there are some swashbuckling tales in here as well. There are a few stories where Robin Hood and his men have fights with the sheriff and his men, and then those stories do have more of the Errol Flynn swashbuckling vibe to them. So it's a bit mixed, but overall the kind of episodic folklore tone of these seemed to be strong, in my opinion. What else do I want to say about this? It's a children's book. It's written for children. Like I said before, I actually tried to read this when I was 7 years old and couldn't get through it. But of course, I was never that bright as a kid. I actually tried to read a lot of classics when I was around that age, and most of them I couldn't get through. Treasure Island, the Wind in the Willows, Sherlock Holmes, Connecticut Yankee and King Arthur's Court. There's a huge list of books like that, which I just found a little bit tough going as a kid, and have enjoyed as an adult, even though I couldn't get through them as a kid. A lot of the Victorian classics, the Victorian children's classics, have been like that for me. Because, you know, I mean, this book is deliberately written in a somewhat archaic style. But even if it weren't, the style has changed over the years, so that those 19th century Victorian classics, even though they were meant for kids at the time, sometimes can be hard going for kids nowadays, or at least it was for me when I was younger. But as an adult, of course, it's no problem, and it's very easy reading. And you know, it, I mean, I do feel a little bit silly as an adult reading this book that was written for kids, and the stakes and the tone and the general themes of the book are all squarely for kids. You know, I mean, it's quite silly, really. Robin Hood and his merry men are living this fantastical life where everything is perfect for them in the forest, and it's always spring, and they always go out and have some fun with the sheriffs and his men, but there are never any serious consequences. That kind of children's fantasy story. I'm using fantasy here, even though there's no magic here, but it's the idea that even though there's no magic, it's essentially a fantasy. Just the idea that there are no consequences to anybody's actions. It can still be quite fun. And I think we all enjoy occasionally getting a break from heavier reading and going back to the simpler pleasures of children's literature. I know I do. According to Wikipedia, Howard Pyle is actually making a lot of adjustments to these ballads as he's writing them into the novel. He's toning down the violence. So, for example, in there's the opening scene, Robin Hood fights the king's foresters, and that's how he becomes an outlaw. In the original ballad, and also in the 1984 Fisher-Price classic cassette tape and comic book that I grew up on, Robin Hood actually ends up killing all the foresters. Or I think in the Fisher-Price version, he kills all the foresters but one. But that's softened down here, so that he only kills one forester. And in general, nobody really dies in this book, except the one forester, Guy of Gisborne. And then it actually does become quite dark at the end. In the epilogue, a number of people die. There's a rather weird tone shift that comes in at the epilogue. But yeah, in general, it's made much more child-friendly by toning down the violence. Also, there's an effort to make this more of a coherent story by putting some of the character names the same. So, for example, if there's like a wrestler in one of the ballads that nobody ever hears from again, Howard Pyle will make this wrestler one of Robin Hood's merry men that was previously introduced in a previous chapter, so that the names are more consistent across Howard Pyle's novel than they would be in the ballads. And then he will quite often put he quite often combine stories or put one story inside of another. For example, in the original ballads, there's a story about how Robin Hood goes off in search of this friar that he's heard so much about, and he and the friar have a little bit of a fight, and then the friar, who of course is Friar Tuck, ends up joining Robin Hood's band. In Howard Pyle's version, he takes the pre-existing story of Allan a Dale and how Robin Hood is helping Allan a Dale get married to his one true love, which is another story from the ballads. And then he puts a story about how Robin Hood met Friar Tuck inside of that story, because now Robin is going out to seek out the friar because he needs the friar's help so that they can have a sympathetic priest to marry Allan a Dale to his true love. So stories are amalgamated like that. Stories are put together like that to try and make it more of a coherent novel. But even with all that, it still does feel very episodic, and you can definitely see where all these different episodes started out as separate stories. What else do I want to say about this book? There's a couple themes which come up quite frequently in the book. One is the love of food and drink. Robin Hood and his men love eating and they love drinking. And it's very frequently described how happy they are eating this or that food and washing it down with sweet ale. Not only Robin Hood and his men, but, you know, then when we meet the sheriff and his men or any group of people in this book, they really like eating and drinking a lot. But Robin Hood and his men are the ones we spend the most time with. So we hear them talking about how good their breakfast is, and we hear about them washing it down with really tasty ale or sweet ale. It's always talking about how good the ale is. There are a couple of passages where the characters are just praising how happy life is when you're drinking good ale and stuff like that in the conversations. And that struck me as a little bit funny in a book written for kids. Not that I necessarily need to take a puritanical stance on this, like, oh, it isn't that sinful or something like that. But, you know, it just seemed like it was a bit of a tease. I mean, if kids can't drink alcohol yet for another 15 years or 10 years or whatever, well, what's the point of having them read this story where you're constantly telling them how delicious it is and how wonderful life is when you're drinking good ale? Beer and wine also pop up occasionally, but ale is the most frequent. The other theme which pops up a lot is the love of nature. So Sherwood Forest is always described in very idyllic terms. It talks about the smells of the forest, the sweet moss, the birds singing, the trees growing. And then Robin Hood and his men will quite often leave Sherwood Forest to go into Nottingham Town. But then it talks about, you know, these pastoral scenes with the rolling hills and the cows grazing and the birds singing again. It's noticeable that it's always a nice spring day all throughout this story, this book. Nothing ever happens in winter. I think winter is alluded to occasionally at the beginning of a chapter. So, the beginning of a chapter will start off and it will say something like, "So winter finished again, and once again it was a beautiful spring day." But we never spend any time in winter. All these stories always take place in the spring, which again strikes me as another reason these books are a little bit fantastical. Another thing that pops up a lot, which I thought was a bit funny, is Robin Hood loves to fight everyone he meets. There's a story pattern which repeats itself over and over again through this book. And I suspect this is a legacy of the being composed of a bunch of separate ballads, that you have this repetitive story pattern. But Robin Hood will meet somebody on the road or in the forest. He'll get into an argument with them over something really silly. Then they'll have a big fight, and then Robin Hood will say, "Boy, you are a really good fighter. How would you like to join my band of merry men?" And the other guy would say, "What? You're Robin Hood? Well, why didn't you tell me? Of course I want to join your band of merry men." Everybody always wants to join Robin Hood's band of merry men. Nobody ever turns them down. Seems like this is like everyone's dream, is always to join the band. So that struck me as a little bit, well, it got a little bit repetitive after a while. It also struck me as maybe a little bit funny. And it also struck me that, you know, Robin Hood and his men really love a fight. You know, they almost come off like hoodlums or thugs sometimes with their eagerness to fight over minor things. My time is just about up here. This camera's going to shut off at 30 minutes, but there's just one more thing I want to talk about, which is the illustrations. Now, this is unique to this book here, this edition here, which is the Sterling one. But Howard Pyle was in his own life a very famous illustrator. And in the original version, he made his own illustrations for this book, which you can find on Wikipedia if you go to Wikicommons or something like that. But they didn't use his original illustrations. They got somebody else, somebody to make these other illustrations, which are all right, I guess, if you look at some of these. But why didn't they go with the originals? I don't understand.